in fact, who is a colleague from Aalborg University in Denmark, and I have a special affinity with that university. We've had partnerships, and we still have a partnership with Aalborg University. And also I happened to undertake my PhD there some years ago in the international program. And so sometimes I'm there working with Bolette, and it's really lovely to welcome you. I'm sorry it's not in person, but we're really excited to hear about your research. So over to you, Bolette, and welcome. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Helen. And thank you for all of you who have joined this webinar. I've called my presentation, "The Music Gives Calmness to the Soul," because it's a quotation from one of the refugees who has participated in music therapy with us. I've chosen the project that I have been part of for the past 5 years, because it has been a very huge endeavor, not only to be able to do the research into an under-researched area, but also to meet all these incredible people from different countries. And I will start with a little music, just a little tiny bit of music to remind ourselves of our inner resources. But as we listen to stories about trauma and trauma, sometimes it resonates with our own traumas. So it's important to keep the feet on the ground and remember the positive resources we all contain. So this is a little piece of music, just 1 minute, just to ground yourself and maybe contact some of the positive memories you have or your own feeling of strength in the moment. So please feel free just to breathe with the music, close your eyes or do whatever you like. Thank you. So please turn back to and open your eyes if you have closed them, and just keep in contact with that positive imagery or strength or grounding feeling that you found here throughout the speech. Not that it will be so overwhelming, but just as a reminder, because when we work with trauma, we also always need to center ourselves and in our positive states once in a while. The outline of this speech will be that I will start with some context for the research, and then I will go into some of the problems that traumatized refugees face, and then I will talk some go into some theoretic stuff about trauma and music therapy as a background for why we chose the intervention we have chosen to work with, which is in music and imagery method. Then I will tell about the research and our results, and I will finish with a couple of case examples with video clips. The research I was a part of took place in a trauma clinic in the psychiatry. It was a specialized clinic for refugees, and it was in a region of Denmark, which is close to the capital, Copenhagen. And the clinic has three locations and a yearly intake of around 200 refugees with PTSD diagnosis. And all the patients were treated ambulance. They were coming into the clinic. They were not living inside in the hospital, but they came for their therapy. And they were treated by a team of psychologists, social workers, physiotherapists, music therapists, and translators. And the treatment followed national guidelines, where a package is including assessment and 4 to 5. Quite a few of the treatment of the refugees needed more than one package, or they came back for more therapy because of their huge degree of traumatization. So so 4 to 5 months is not a lot when you have been exposed to, for example, to torture. up here in Aalborg, which Helen talked about, where the university is located, where we have our music therapy education and international graduate school. The teams behind this refugee research was five music therapists who also had GIM training, Tobin Moe as a PI, Katarina Steen and myself. And here are the names of the steering group, because all research takes place in, you know, many people supports research and fund. It's not just the funding, it's so many, there's so many problems and so many processes to take hand of. So all the leading professors and doctors from the hospital were supporting the research. I think you might remember this image. It is a Danish photo from when the people from Syria came marching up the highways in the Europe, Danish highway. We know from the UNHCR that there are now over 80 million refugees in the world, which is the highest number ever. And 26 million of them are refugees and have crossed borders. The rest are living internally in the countries. Jan Egeland, who is the Secretary General of the Norwegian Refugee Council, has said that international responsibility sharing for displaced people has utterly collapsed. Rich countries are building walls against families fleeing war at the same time as less money is available for aid to people in conflict areas. And we can also feel that in Denmark, because there was a cut down in economics for refugees during the period of research. I've made this slide to show some of the complex and multiple stressors existing in the refugee lives, starting from left, traumatic experiences from war, dangerous flights, loss of homeland, loss of home, loss of your future perspective, friends, relatives, sometimes long periods of waiting for asylum and family reunion, lots of symptoms, bad sleeping, pain, flashbacks, anger, memory problems, exhaustion, withdrawal, socioeconomic problems and worries about family in the homeland, and also acculturation difficulties, learning a new language, getting a new network, and adapting into a new culture is very different if you are at the same time traumatized. What is a trauma? Sometimes we ask ourselves that, and I have one definition here. Trauma is the response to a deeply distressing or disturbing event that overwhelms an individual's ability to cope, causes feelings of helplessness, diminishes their sense of self, and their ability to feel a full range of emotions and experiences. And the important thing is the response, because trauma is not defined by the trigger or the event, but by the response. And you can say that trauma disrupts the flow of life, because the response to trauma narrows your life energy. The diagnosis post-traumatic stress disorder is actually one of the only diagnoses which addresses an event from a person's life instead of just symptoms. So it's very usable. And it is composed of three symptoms: the intrusion, hyperarousal, and avoidance. The complex PTSD diagnosis has been added later and is part of the ICD-11. And if you have PTSD, you can have complex PTSD on top of that. And very many refugees have that, because they are so multiple traumatized. Some of them have traumas from childhood, and some of them have been imprisoned for a long time. So that means that it's a more complex traumatization, which can impact on self-organization and affect the affect regulation and the self-concept and the interpersonal domains. And for example, also cause a loss of basic trust and trust in other human beings. Furthermore, high amounts of insecure attachment patterns have been demonstrated in refugees associated with dissociative patterns, so that even if you have a safe attachment pattern as a child, multiple traumas can affect this basic trust and make it as a transferred into an insecure attachment style. One of our patients in an interview said before trauma treatment, "I was not able to do something, for example, go to work or study or do some positive thing. I was just like, I was wondering that if I do this thing, maybe it would be a big danger for me." So this is about losing trust in the world, that everything seemed to be dangerous, so he stayed at home. I mean, by myself, I was not able to do anything. At that time, I had to ask someone what to do and what not to do. I lost my concentration. So you will hear about this man later. Research and treatment for refugees in general have demonstrated that across disciplinary treatment, as in our clinic, is recommended generally. And there have been several systematic reviews and also meta-analysis in this area, and they have described low medium effect on trauma symptoms after, for example, narrative exposure therapy, EMDR, and cognitive behavioral therapy. Trauma-focused. These systematic reviews are the absolute newest. There exist a lot of, or there maybe five or six more. Recently, some studies have pointed to the problems in the barriers to coming into clinics for treatment for the refugees, and language barriers for the first have been found to be difficult. And also other cultural barriers and stigmatization and fear of being looked at as psychiatric ill if they go to treatment has been barriers. You can also find in literature the mentioning of the threat of working with trauma on a cognitive level without strategies for autonomic and affective regulation, and also giving too early and too direct exposure, resulting in a lot of dropout in studies. Some of the treatments of music therapy is, for example, music therapy or music activity-based studies where there's a reach out service or freelance projects in refugee camps or centers that can be in the original countries. And one union called Music for Refugees have been showing very beautiful results. Previous studies on clinical or community music therapy interventions with refugees are sparse, but there are a study showing that guided imagery and music in groups demonstrated some symptom decrease for refugee trauma victims. Alan, who is a Finnish PhD, demonstrated in a case study analysis of three torture survivors that when they listened to music, they could tolerate to talk about their emotions afterwards. The Norwegian Roaldsnes in her PhD showed that Afghan unaccompanied minors benefited from song groups. They were interviewed and she found that the emotional change increased sense of belonging and increased coping was found after the music therapy or song group. Then the Italians, Herring and the Angelis is working with immigrant children's second languages. And the same is another Norwegian PhD student, which I didn't bring in here, but I will put it in the slides. And there have been a lot of qualitative studies and case reports, and they have demonstrated increased sense of group belonging, language acquisition, coping, mutual support, and expressiveness in refugee women participating in music therapy groups. Only three small studies exist, quantitative studies in this area. There has been two studies in young refugees going to schools in their new countries, and one was a study where periods with music therapy was compared to periods without music therapy. And they found, the Jones and Baker found, that there was significantly less depression and aggressive behavior in periods with music therapy than in periods without. And Choi, who is a Korean researcher living in the United States, also found that there was less depression, anxiety, and hopelessness after group music therapy compared to art classes. Then a Danish study has been using music listening before sleep with music pillows, 3 weeks of listening, and they found that the sleep quality increased significantly in those who listened to music before sleep compared to the others. There might be other studies that I don't know of, but this is, I know that there's very few quantitative studies in refugee populations, and that was why I was also so keen on this project. And why you, we know that PTSD affects deeper layers of the brain associated with stress response, emotion, and implicit memory, and inhibits cognitive functions and verbal processing. Music stimulates these areas directly and can trigger neuroplasticity and neurogenesis. Music also affects brain chemistry, like the stress system, the dopamine, and the motivation systems, and the social attachment system measured with oxytocin and other chemicals. Music in the range of the human voice has been found to activate a feeling of safety and to stimulate the social engagement response. And music therapy can be culture adapted and use the musical taste and expertise of the refugees, bringing about empowerment to the participant. Music also can stimulate imagery of inner resources, and music can influence the autonomic nervous system and provide a supportive structure for trauma exposure. Shifting between music listening and verbal interaction provide integration between sensation, affect, and cognition. And this is a neuropsychiatrist from Italy who have found that. We know that not only music listening, but also playing together, drumming together, singing is very powerful music therapy methods. But in our case, we were not able to use this method because of the clinics we were working in, because of place and noise. So we had to use the music listening method, and we tried to adapt this, and I will come back to that. Maybe some of you know the PhD Peter Levine, who have been writing about trauma for quite some years. His basic theory is connected to the idea that unexpressed defense reactions connected to the traumatic experience or episode is leading to a dysregulation of the autonomic nervous system. The instinctual defense mechanism is, for example, fight, flight, freeze, shutdown, feint, dead. And Peter Levine found that treatment with a focus on the defense responses on a bodily level can be facilitated with a pendulation between trauma fragments and resource imagery. And this is called the renegotiation of trauma. And we use this idea to work directly with the pendulation between memories of flashbacks of trauma and positive resource imagery. And on here on the in the illustration, you can again see the river of life and how the trauma disrupts this, and how there's the trauma vortex and the healing vortex, that pendulation between those two can start to integrate and make the river flow again, so to speak. This is just one of the trauma trauma theories that we were using, but I cannot, you know, talk about the whole spectrum today. Another spectrum that we built our method on was that an overwhelming experience tends to split up the psyche in an attempt of self-protection. For example, dissociation of emotions and body sensations from memories of situations. The traumatic incidents cannot be integrated in the body self, and it keeps repeating itself through nightmares and flashbacks. There's a feeling of time being suspended and living in the now of the trauma. So when you are in a flashback, it's like you are back in the trauma and you are in it as a now. So the goal of therapy is to integrate bit for bit the trauma and all connected sensations and feelings and cognitive decisions, such as the world is dangerous, as part of the life history, and to put it in the past. Music and imagery is a way of working directly with the trauma, because the body in a way tends to experience imagery in the same level as real experiences. So if you change a trauma history in the imagery, the body responds as if it's changed, and that's very smart. So we were all educated in the bunny method of guided imagery and music, which has proved to be helpful for trauma survivors. This method is using up to 45 minutes of music with the client in a declined position in an altered state of consciousness, where the therapist speaks to the client about what is coming up in the imagery. And we all felt that this was too heavy for this population. It would have been re-traumatizing, and it was not appropriate to use. However, there exists an adaptation called music and imagery, and it has been used in psychiatry for more than 20 years, and it uses one piece of music only. The patient sits on a chair, can keep the eyes open, and does not need to talk during the music. And we use this method and adapted it by including calm music from other genres and styles, including music from refugee countries, and also by working in a phase trauma treatment with different music choices and different approaches in each phase. And if you know Judith Herman's trauma and recovery from the 90s, these stages or phases is still the same that are used internationally for trauma treatment. There's a safety and stabilizing phase. And then there's a trauma exposure phase, remembrance and mourning. And then there is a reconnection phase, where it's about having a future, working on social connections and getting on with your life. What we found that when we use music, we needed a stage 1.5, because we saw that the music kind of enabled the patients to feel different emotions while just listening to music. So it was a preface to being able to process trauma, that they were actually able to hold both grief and hope and rage and all kinds of feeling because of the music. So we didn't go on to trauma treatment or to exposure before they had, you know, opened up to more level, a more tolerant state towards their emotions. And I will just show you one of the models we worked with, where you can see the client and the therapist and the translator in a triadic working union with embodied resonant arousal regulation to music. And you can see that the music is a holding space. There are supportive inner resources, which we try to get in to help with the trauma reactions and emotional path, split of paths in the imagery experience. So now I'm going to tell you about the research. In the feasibility study that we started up with, we had 16 refugees, 10 men and 6 women. And they had 16 weekly 1-hour sessions of music and imagery. They got a music CD for listening between sessions. We had permissions to video record all of the sessions. We gave them questionnaires before and after the therapy course. And we also carried out semi-structured interviews of all the 16 persons. And here is the paper that came out after the feasibility study. So I give you the reference in the end. The results of the pilot study was that they accepted the treatment well. 25% of the music we used in session was from the refugees' countries of origin. So they accepted our classical Western music and film music and meditative music very well. Here to the right, you can see how the PTSD symptoms decreased. And it was a significant decrease with a high effect size. Similarly, the sleep disturbances decreased from pre-therapy to post-therapy. And the well-being increased from pre to post-therapy. And all results were significant and with large effect sizes. In the interviews, we found that during therapy, the relationship with the therapist was very important for the refugees. And they experienced that the music changed their emotion and thoughts. Sometimes they had difficult emotions, but they all felt that that the music had some effect on their emotions, which was very important for them. And they felt that the therapy had changed their state. They had less tension and pain, and less negative thoughts and emotions, and they had increased hope. They used the music method in everyday life after treatment, and they felt more initiative and agency in everyday life. We thought that these results were very powerful, so we went to the administration of the clinic and asked if they were willing to do a randomized clinical trial with us. And they said yes. And after our first application, we had a million kroner, Danish kroners grant. I don't know what it is in your currency, but it's a lot. So we felt very lucky, but we have very little time to plan it. And here to the right, you can see the protocol that we published. It's open access and easy to find. So what we planned was to try to prove that music and imagery was as good as verbal psychotherapy. The refugees was randomized to one of two treatments, and it was an active control. They again had 16 sessions, or between 12 and 20, to facilitate a little slack. And they were also home listening in the music group. We took in Arabic, English, or Danish speaking refugees because we tried to keep it into a more focused population, but we didn't succeed in that because a lot of the people that came from Kosovo and Balkan areas, they already had learned Danish, so we had a mixed population. We carried out therapy in three different cities, three different locations, with three different teams. And the design, which I told you about, was called a non-inferiority trial. And this is a little specific, but it's not like, you know, you compare two groups and see who is the strongest. Actually, the object objective of non-inferiority is to compare a novel treatment to a known active treatment to demonstrate that it is not clinically worse. For example, it could also be less expensive or more gentle or more easy to handle with the population. And we thought that our music therapy treatment was more gentle compared to verbal treatment because it was the arousal was more regulated with the music and it was easier to get into a treatment alliance with the refugees because of the music. So the hypothesis in a non-inferiority design is that music and imagery is as good as verbal psychotherapy. And you measure it with a small defined interval that is decided before, that it should be as good as within this interval. I don't know if you know intention to treat and per protocol principles, but it's about including all or only including those who did the whole data collection or therapy. So we in this approach, we analyzed both groups. So the outcome measures was PTSD symptoms. The Harvard Trauma Questionnaire is validated internationally in different refugee groups. The attachment scale, adult attachment scale, dissociation scales, both one called dissociative symptom scales and somatic dissociation questionnaire. The well-being we used again, and then we took in some biomarker measuring where we collected saliva pre-post some of the session and pre-post the whole therapy. And this was my kind of main idea. I would like to see if oxytocin, the social connection hormone, was increased when they had therapy and especially when they had music therapy. But these samples are still in the deep freezer because of Corona. I'm so sad about that, but I hope they will come up one day. Then we had post-session questions on helpfulness of intervention and important themes. And the late Italian psychiatrist Liotti said that trauma, dissociation, and disorganized attachments are three strands of a single braid. And that's the theory behind why we chose these outcome measures, because we saw that they were connected. The same amount of therapy hours was given to the two groups of the study, and both had face treatment, both have interpreters, no EMDR was given in any of the group, and they all patients could have medication or social advice or body therapy as well. We just kept the we just counted how much they got. And here is, you know, you don't have to read it all, but the sample was equally composed in both of the groups, and there were many males. This is not that usual in music therapy studies. The most of them came to the country after or year 2000, and actually we had half of our sample were from Syria. There were almost a third who had also experienced childhood abuse, like beating or rape or seeing a war actions. And there were half of the sample had been exposed to torture, and a third had been in prison. Another a third of them had all was on medication of some kind. So it was quite the sample was, you know, people with many, many problems. And here's the flowchart. And what is important is that we actually saw a very huge dropout rate in the verbal psychotherapy group, 40% dropped out, and we had in the music group 5%. This was, of course, because music therapy worked very well, but it's also because there were some restructurations in the clinic. There was some turnover in the psychologists group, and there was also some bad leading problems. Here are some of the results. The main result is to the right. This is the non-inferiority result. And what you can see here is that that's the point, delta is 0.3, and you need to be over that to be non-inferior. And actually, both at post and follow-up, and both in ITT and in PP populations, we kept to the side, except we were on the spot here. But overall, this means that music therapy was non-inferior to verbal to verbal therapy. And here to the left, you can see in a more comprehensive graphic display that the music therapy group had decreased trauma symptoms, and the tau group didn't change so much. And the music therapy group started in a worse level than the others. But none of the groups had a really huge change of trauma symptoms. So it was, and it is because of the severe multiple traumatization in this group. Here you can see, you can follow it more after 6-11 sessions, how the change came about. So there's a drop here after 6 sessions, and then it goes up again almost to the end. And then in the follow-up period, the music therapy dropped a lot. And we think that is because of the music listening that they continued to do after the therapy had ended in the 6 months here. Well-being is not quite often measured in this population, and we actually had a significant increase in well-being in the music therapy group, as you can see here, the 2 stars, both after therapy and at follow-up. The dissociation is also rare to measure, and here you can see that in the both groups, the dissociation decreased. But in the music therapy, it decreased significantly with a large effect size. And it was a psychological dissociation, not the somatic dissociation. I will not display the attachment measures because it's very difficult to read. It's not the normal attachment styles we were measuring. But I can tell you that the depend and close subscales changed significantly from baseline to end of treatment in both of the groups, and which can mean that both treatments increased the feeling of closeness to others and the feeling of trust in others in the population. Some limitations in the ICT is that the large dropout resulted in a much smaller sample that we had estimated in the power calculation. And a huge problem was that the verbal therapy treatment was not validated or manualized, and no pre-existing effect size was available. So we had to estimate the effect of the comparator, and that is not really the way it should be. And that was because we couldn't manualize the psychologists. They each had their ideas about how to treat the refugees, but they were old and experienced, so we thought they did a good work. We were not able to put them into a manual. And that was, of course, a weakness of the study. So a summary of the findings is that 74 participants were included in the study. We had a high retention rate in the music therapy group and a large dropout in the tau. Non-inferiority of music therapy was found. no statistical significant changes of trauma symptoms were found in any of the interventions. The music therapy group demonstrated significant increase of well-being and decrease of psychological dissociation at follow-up. And here is the result article, which is on its way out, and it will be open access to. Before going into the some of the case examples, I will just share with you that we had some clinical challenges. One of them is that it can be a hard work to work with this population because the trauma is so pervasive, and it's a huge it's very, very important that you have supervision and that you are in a team where you can almost every day talk about how it is to be with these patients. We also had some refugees that were very fragile and couldn't tolerate music at all in the beginning. And for them, we sometimes played this instrument you can see to the right, which is called a body tampura. And we did some humming and playing, and then they gradually became able to listen to music. We had problems with finding music from the refugees' own countries because Middle Eastern music tends to be fast and changing and rhythmic or very, very sad. So we used, it's some very time, it took some time to find good numbers.
The letter. You asked me to interrupt you at 6:15.
Yes, so I'm actually on the spot, so.
Great, I'm just letting you know.
The last thing I would say from this slide is that there are some, in this population, some of the musicians and singers has been tortured because of their music, for example, the Kurd population. And it is very tricky to do music therapy with this group. I did it with three refugees, and they all loved music very much, but each time we put music on, they also flipped to sorrow and despair. So it was very tricky. So you have to watch out for whenever music has been used in torture or people with musician backgrounds have been tortured if you meet this population. And also it's a number one to use music very, very careful. If you are going to use music listening with this group, play a little 10 seconds of it before you put it on, just to check if their nervous system can take it in. So I will show some video clips from the pilot study with permission from the patients, and after that there are time for questions. Questions?
Thank you.
And a list of music homework.
Thank you so much, Bolette. Music gives calmness to the soul. I think that is such a moving and fitting way to end. And there are some questions. Thank you so much. It's also such a good example of guided imagery in music, which is not practiced as much, but is growing in its use in the UK and is, I know, very prevalent in many other countries and especially Denmark. So much. So some of the questions are, so one question from Paniotis Naturnodopis is, what criteria did you use to choose the music played?
Yeah, there were different criteria in the phases. In the first phase, which was about stabilization and then calming down symptom loads and getting a good connect each other. Here we tried to find calm music, slow music, was not that much repetitive music, no dynamic. No strong intensity, so it could be a holding music for calming down. And then we also asked the refugee, what music do you like? Do you have any memories of good memories, and what kind of music is it connected to? So we choose sometimes their music, and sometimes we exercised breathing or stabilizing exercises and trying to find safe places in the imagery. And when we went into the exposure phase, we used slightly more strong music. From session to session, we tried to mirror the state of the refugee in their nervous system. How much was that window of tolerance? How much could they take?
Yeah, thank you. And I suppose for those who might not be familiar with guided imagery and music, there's also a wealth of material that's categorized where music has been categorized by previous researchers and clinicians such as Helen Bonney and others into groups of pieces of music that might be helpful in certain situations. And yes, so many questions. There's also many comments. Thank you for such a moving, informative presentation, and also people commenting on the statistical outcomes and things like Henry Dunn comments 49% reduction in cortisol levels. And then you talked about the importance of how significant the outcomes are. I did have a question about the teams of music therapists. I wondered how many there were across the whole, each study, but.
Yeah, we were four in each study.
Okay, thank you.
No, that's not three in the first and four in the second.
Yes, so coming back to questions from the audience. So another question is, did you use imagery after each piece of music? So I think that's more about the technique of guided imagery and music, maybe.
Normally, we use the music to get into imagery.
Yeah.
Sometimes, if they were in a flashback, we could use the music to finish the flashback or change the flashback or getting out of the flashback by introducing a safe place.
Yes.
Sometimes we used drawing so that they could look at the drawing. But we didn't work with imagery out of the music.
And just to confirm that there have also been some questions about the outcome measures and other things about what's the music pillow, and they've been answered during the time, either by another comment from you or Nina's been also answering some of the points. And we've put the link to the publication about music pillow study. And there's a comment from, I'm a person from Turkey. There are a lot of refugees in my country, and there's a music group to martyr study.
Yes, I know that. We use some of their music too. It's quite nice.
Great. Nina, I'm just going to bring you in to see if you've moderated any final questions, because we have to stop at 6:30, so we're running out of time.
Yes, I think Maria had a question about the wooden string instrument.
Oh, yes.
Was it, what was the instrument that you used?
This is called a body tampura, and it's tuned in fifths and octaves, so it's not in harmony, so it's just a kind of a sound quality that you can sing over, and you can sing in different scales. So it's very usable. You can sing Arabic scales or major scales. So and you can put it on the body and to make some vibrations if you have pain, which many of the refugees have. So we thought it was a nice instrument to add as a receptive music therapy tool. But I must admit, I played with some of the musicians also. So.
Thank you so much. There's also questions about accessing the slides. And Nina, you probably want to round off by explaining how people can access the recording. I want to thank you so much, Bolette. It is such a wealth of material and such groundbreaking work and out there in the public. Publications as well, so a lot to follow up for everyone, I think. And thank you so much for this really important work. And I'll hand over to Nina.
Yeah, I really hope that this method can be used more in refugee care and also in the care of veterans and people who have been exposed to violence or rape. I think this myth could be used wide. worldwide in trauma populations. So feel free to contact me.
Yes. And great. Also in, yeah. And also people like Martin Laws and others who are in the UK, you know, who are also here, I think, tonight. And there is GIM training in the UK. Nina, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, everyone, and for all of your comments in the chat. It looks like everyone really enjoyed this final lecture. I've just put the link to our YouTube channel, the Research Institute. So we have most of our webinars from this year recorded on there. So feel free to go and watch back anything that you might have missed this year. And also, once we finish up, a survey will pop up on your screen, and there you'll have the opportunity to put in your email to join our mailing list, and that way you'll find out about next year's series as well. So we'll be starting back up in September in a couple of months' time. So thank you all for coming today, and I'm so glad you enjoyed the lecture, and we hope to see you soon.
Yes. See you all soon. Thank you. Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Hi.
Can I see the chat? Oh, yes. I can. Oh, there's a lot.
You should be able to. Yes, there are. And there are many, many comments thanking you and.
Wow.
Fascinating presentation.
Yeah, can I? No, I can't save it. You can save it.
I can save it. I could send you the.
I would like that because yeah. I don't have time for listening or for reading right now. So.
Yeah, no worries.
It would be nice to see it. Yeah, I'm so happy to share this work because it was such a deep work and it was so life-changing.
I must say I've heard you speak about it a while ago, but this is so sort of clear and finished and complete, and it's very validating, I think, in relation to the field, and especially in relation to guided imagery and music. And I suppose I've got a question about that. You know, I wonder if there's another study where we look at different approaches to music therapy, or whether we just say, well, look, we can see that GIM is working. So let's use it.
Good question. We'll try again. I'm not sure about the question, but maybe it wasn't a question.
No, I'm just thinking aloud about the difference between active improvisational music therapy, and you explain why that wasn't used, and GIM, and that these things happen through guided imagery and music. So I was just thinking, whether there's any way of comparing these different approaches, or whether we just agree that you've done this work and GIM is, I could see so many advantages to it for this population.
I would have liked to also play music with these people, but some of them were actually very, very fragile. They couldn't have played or sang a tone.
Yes.
So they're really kind of fallen apart people.
Yeah, sure.
They barely can go to the clinic.
Yes.
And barely can afford to go to the clinic. So sometimes it's about, you know, keeping them alive.
Yeah, absolutely.
So some of them couldn't have been tolerating live music. And I think also that's important to remember that when you see all these nice people of bands and refugees drumming together, a lot of them would just, you know, they would have not...
Sure.
Been able to be there, so it's also about different categories in as a different levels of treatment.
Yeah, no, you made that very clear about the levels.
Yeah.
Of trauma.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it has been so touching to meet people mm-hmm. that have been through hell and they actually kind of survived and you know were so trustful that they even dared to tell about it. Not, you know, in details, but enough for them to process some of it. And I'm so grateful to have been close to these people, because sometimes, you know, your view of life changes when you meet this kind of people.
Yes. And just for the recording, just to finish, because you probably have to go. I think you said you have to go. There is another question, which is about what about the balance between men and women? Because you said there were more men than women, and that was unusual. But also, there's a question about whether there's work like this planned with children. Or
yes, not refugee children, I think, but with other children, yes.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
So thank you so much. I think we will say goodbye and.
Thank you for now, and thank you for inviting me. I'm happy about it, and you promised to pick out the trauma part, the examples in the end. I put them together in the end too.
Sure.
And the image of Mohammed, it's okay for him. He's okay with it, but I don't want the film out and of the process.
Yeah, we'll edit those out.
Good.
Hope to see you maybe in Edinburgh in person. You never know.
Yes. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I really hope so. Keep well.
Yeah, and you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye.